Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our first TalkAbout. On behalf of the Mexican Society, UCL Mexican Society, I would like to thank our first speaker. She is Citlali Helenes, and I'm going to introduce her background. She studied pharmacobiological chemistry at the University of California, and she also has a master in neuroscience from UCL. And nowadays, she is studying a PhD in the Institute of Child Health. And she's going to talk about neural tissue engineering. Can we build a brain? Thank you.
Hello, thank you for coming. So I just want to say this is my PhD project, but I just started a couple of months ago. So I'm not really going to present to you any results because I really don't have anything interesting to say about that. But I'm going to explain what's it going to be about. So as the title says, I want to try to build a neural tissue in the hopes of understanding and trying to respond to the question, can we build a brain? Okay, so first of all, before trying to understand how can we build a brain, we don't really know how the brain works. So, and we don't really know how it develops. So we need to understand how it develops from a single cell and how it forms a whole brain. So when we all start like this, right? So we all start like a couple of cells with no defined structure, with no defined, I can't really see a hand here or a face, but that's human, right? So we can see that from two cells, we have four cells. How does that happen? Well, that's only because it divided, okay? So far, so good, it just divided. Then we still have four identical cells, but then we have a whole bunch of cells. What happened? Well, then they started dividing a little bit more, okay? But then we have something that's like a structure. It's start to forming a little bit of an edge here. So it's not only division, it's also organizing. Those cells are organizing themselves, and something's telling them, you need to go here, you need to go there. So, okay, so what happens when the brain starts forming in a baby? So the very first stages of a brain is this. I don't know if you can see it well, but there's a like a laminal layer there. That's called the neural plate. From that, the cells, you can see that the organization there, it's much more complicated. We have cells in the bottom, cells on the side, and then the cells are gonna start to move and shift and form this groove, which will slowly start closing, and then we'll get the neural tube. So here we have, the cells are still divided, the cells are organizing themselves, but you can see the cells here are much more planar, they look like lines. These lines here are more squiggly. So the cells are not only organizing themselves, they're differentiating themselves. So that's a whole other table. So from this neural tube, the whole central nervous system is going to arise. Your brain, your spinal cord, everything. So this is the very first start. But at the same time, so we see now different structures. We see, we kind of recognize here a tube, here a layer, here another layer, but we still can't recognize the human baby. Can we see a face there? No. So what happens there? How do we jump from that? Can't see it. Can you just turn the light? Because it's really cool, this one. okay. Yeah. So this, okay, so now we see something different. Here we see different structures, and you can see it start to form. You can see a little bit of what it's going to be, a fetus, an embryo, and, okay, so remember the neural tube? The neural tube starts closing, and this is the neural tube. It goes all along this way, and we can see it's already closed here, but if we go up here, it's still open. Why is it still open there? That means that cells here are different than the cells over there, even though they're part of the same neural tube, even though their principal structure is similar. So we can see some other structures we can start to identify. Here we can see what a group of cells that eventually will become the eyes, a group of cells that will eventually become the heart, but the cells look like it doesn't really look human, does it? It looks like a little squiggly, yeah, worm or something, I don't know. So from there, how do we jump to this? okay, so now we kind of see a human head, or at least the head, right? We see some a little bit smaller eyes, not as big as those ones, and the squiggly worm, their orange one, well, now it has different kinds of structures in that squiggly worm. And we can see it. Let's see how it looks all around. We can see that all of the structures, So all of these structures will eventually have a different function. So this means that the cells not only are organizing themselves, are differentiating themselves, they're still dividing, but they have connections with each other and they're communicating with each other. So that is really, really complicated, and exactly how this works, we don't know. We know some mechanisms, we know some signals that happen here and there, because cells communicate with each other and with their environment. Not only the cells need a specific environment to grow in, but if they don't have that specific environment, they're not going to grow the structures that they're supposed to grow in. So after seeing all of this development, we still have something that resembles a kind of human, right? But we still have a long way to go. So what happens next? What kind of differentiation and organization happens to get from this to this? Lovely neuroscience. So even though after we're born, the brain keeps developing, the brain keeps making new neurons, and the brain keeps making new connections and everything, so the whole ordeal from one cell to get this, it's so complicated, and so it takes 9 months, you know, well, not this, but it's a little bit more than 9 months, but it's something that we don't actually understand quite well. So if we want to know how to build a brain, we first have to know how the brain is formed. So with that, we need to, I want you to ask yourselves, why would someone or why would researchers want to build a brain? So the first thing that most people think of in why to build a brain is maybe, well, like other tissue engineering strategies in trying to build organs is, well, you want an organ so you can transplant it into a person that needs that organ. So a lot of people think, okay, so if we build a brain, then maybe we can have head transplants, or maybe I can have a new brain or something. Well, yeah, that would be really, really useful sometimes. But if we don't know how to build it, how are you gonna build, how are you gonna get a whole brain? So for that, we really have to ask us, how does it function? And how are we going to study how the brain develops? This is how we study brain cells right now. These are human neural stem cells. So these are stem cells that will eventually become neurons and other cell brains. So, brain cells, sorry. But this is how we study them right now in the lab. This is a flat surface. Yeah, they're ones next to each other. They look nice and everything, but they're growing in not only a flat surface, but in plastic. And you don't really find plastic in your brain, do you? So how does this resemble the real thing? How would we expect that the results we get from these experiments are real results, or not real results, but are mimicking what happens in our body? We can't. It's not the same thing, because cells are responding to the signals from the plastic, from the interactions with each other, but they don't have that little cozy home that they had when they normally develop in a brain or in a child. So this is one of my main why I want to build a neural tissue, so we can actually study how cells really do behave in the real thing, in the brain, and we can get more real results, let's say. So how am I gonna do this? How can we construct neural models? So there are a lot of different ways to do this. So first of all, I'm gonna talk about the self-assembly strategy. What does this tell us? So like the name says, the cells self-assemble. kind of like we were seeing in a baby. They know where to go, what to do, so they self-assemble. And one of the most notable examples we have of that is the cerebral organoids. What this means is basically researchers grab a bunch of cells, a group of cells, their stem cells, they push them in the right direction, a little push, not a big one, and then they just let them be. They just like do what you do best. And they got this, something resembling a brain. So we can see the fine structures actually. We can see different kinds of cells interacting with each other. We have structures that actually resemble what happens in the real brain. But is this a brain? No, it's not fully developed. But at the same time, it's really interesting. I mean, the cells knew how to do this all by themselves. But what's the problem with this? Well, when you're working in the lab and you want to do experiments and trying to test something, you want to do it a lot of times and trying to test different conditions. So if you don't know what's exactly happening here, we go to the same dilemma of when a baby's born. The cells are just doing their thing, so we can't really reproduce it because we can't control it. So it's a cool strategy, but there are others. So next, the top-down approach. So this means we're going to control a big structure, in this case, where the cells live, which is called a scaffold, basically, which is the structure where the cells adhere and where they like to nestle. And from there, we're going to put cells into the scaffold and build an organ, basically. So again, notable examples are, for example, when we get an organ, we can actually wash away the cells of the organ, and we can see the cells are washing away, and what we end up with is a decellularized organ. That means there's no cells, but this structure is made of proteins, and these proteins are really good for the cells. So this structure is what the cells like. So you can actually grab, for example, an animal's organ, take away, wash away those cells, end up with this, just a scaffold, and then repopulate it with a patient's cells. That way you can actually transplant it into a patient, into their own patient, and the body will recognize it as its own. We can see that this has been done with a trachea, and it has actually been implanted, and it has also been done with the bladder, and it has actually been implanted. So if we can grow full organs in this with this strategy, why don't we build a brain? Well, there's a big difference between a trachea and a bladder, which are hollow, and their function is really, really basic. So this holds urine, and this just lets air pass, to, say, a brain, or a kidney, or a liver, which is much more complicated. So let me talk to you about the last strategy, the bottom up, which is the opposite. So instead of trying to control the macro structure, we start from the microstructure. So we want to control how the cells interact directly with the scaffold and build the scaffold directly within the cell, with the cells. So how do we do this? So other notable examples are like the 3D printing that right now, there's been a lot of that, and people have actually printed cells. But there's another strategy, bioelectric spray, really important. Why is this so important? Because this is the one that I'm going to use for my project. So what is this? Real quick. It looks complicated. It's not. So basically, we have a syringe where we're going to put our sample, which is the cells, and the matrix, which means the proteins that are going to build the scaffold. So this syringe is going to be connected here. We're just going to push the sample out. And then because of the ground electrodes, there's going to be an electrical force. So with no electrical force, this is what we have. Needle and the liquid coming out. And this is what happens with the 3D printing. The size of the needle is going to be smaller than the size of the drop. So you can't really control how the cells are going to go because cells are much smaller than this. You need something that's going to be finer and that's going to be much, much smaller. So when you apply voltage, the forces, the electrical forces are going to pull on this liquid and are going to form a jet, a stream, a spray. And this spray, you can't really see it here right now, But this little spray here is actually a lot of different drops. So this spray can go up to the micro to the nano size drops. That way you can actually control where each individual cell goes. So how am I going to do this, basically? First, I need to know what kind of cells am I going to use. So basically, different kinds of stem cells. That's it. And I'm going to differentiate them and see if they can make neurons or what kind of neurons they can make. Then I need to see what kind of material I'm going to use. So different kinds of proteins. But at the same time, so you remember if it's a syringe and we form a spray, how is a liquid and a spray, how is that going to form an organ? They need to gelify afterwards, right? So I need to find a way to make it a gel, because most of this don't form gel. Some of them do, but I need to find out the right conditions to make a gel. So I can get, a uniform monodistribution of the cells within the drops. So after that, I can do different things. And one of the most interesting, my part, would be maybe pattern and structure. So maybe if I can control it, I can maybe make a neural tube or a little tube with stem cells inside it. Then I can differentiate those cells and then remember the neural tube. What was it? The first structure of the brain. So if I can make a neural tube, will that mean that maybe the cells will continue their journey and form a whole brain? I don't know, but it will be fun to find out. And so, the aim is to provide a reproducible model to further our understanding of human central nervous system. Because if we can reproduce it, then we can really experiment on it. And if I'm actually successful in trying to produce a model, because we have neural models right now, and the best neural models we have are animals, right? We can make a rat, we can model a disease in a rat, not make a rat, sorry. We can model a disease in a rat, or we can model injuries to the brain in rats. We can do a lot of stuff with animals. But at the end of the day, that information that we get from the animals, it's not the real thing in terms of the clinic, because you always need to know what happens with human cells. So if you can get a model with human cells, you can test it for drugs, you can model diseases, you can do so many things with a human model that we actually don't have right now. There's no human 3D model for us to test it. So with that, I'm going to just ask you this. So let's say that in the future we can actually have the specific structures the brain has. We can actually have the brains connecting with each other, and we have everything resembling a brain, and we can make a brain in the lab, and it's right there in your lab sitting in a petri dish. Would that be your brain? Would that be called a brain? So remember the trachea. Trachea was built, and then it's for the air to pass. The bladder just holds urine. Their brain, what's its function? Its function is to process information. So if you have the cells and the structure and everything, but you don't have any input, any information, then it's not really a brain, is it? So how can we build a brain without any input? Where does that input come from? It comes from your eyes, it comes from your muscles, it comes from everywhere. So does that mean we can't build a brain without having a whole body? Does that mean that we can't build a brain without first building the body, or that the two are connected in a way that we can't really separate them? I don't know. But I'm going to leave you with this other question. Do you think it's a good idea to build a brand new lab?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, Citlali, for your presentation. We have a couple of minutes for
any question that you may have here.